And welcome back to season 3 of the Rooted In podcast. This season is all about conveying important teaching concepts to you through visual and enjoyable images and metaphors.
Which is going to be particularly difficult in a radio format.
But we'll make it work.
So we're just going to describe Tracy's images to you for most of this season.
Okay. Yeah, so put on your thinking caps. Yeah. You're going to have to do a lot of visualizing here.
A podcast is worth 3,000 words.
So we're going to kick off this season with a three-part series that actually will be accompanied by a blog, so we will have an opportunity to show you Tracy's
beautiful artwork.
Yes, beautiful artwork, her visual concepts. And our series is going to be called How Much Language Arts? I get this question all the time. How much reading? How much writing? How much language arts? And it's going to be broken into three parts, introducing this idea and talking about what language arts looks like when we introduce skills. Part two will be what language arts looks like, how much, when kids are gaining skills and practicing their skills. And part three will be how much language arts when kids are solidifying skills and applying skills.
And if you're listening to this, each of these podcasts is also accompanied by a blog. So if you're sitting here listening thinking, oh, I wish I could remember some of those things, a lot of it will be written down for you and you'll get all the visuals with a blog as well.
Each of them is also accompanied by a lovely code, which we'll be giving to you at the end of the podcast as a thank you for listening, little discount code to use on our website.
Right. So I came up with this idea about how much language arts when Tracy and I were working on pinwheels. And I started to say to her, you know, I realized that so often in education, language arts is broken up into minutes. So many minutes of reading, so many minutes of writing, so many minutes of grammar, so many minutes of vocabulary, so many minutes of spelling. What am I forgetting?
Phonics.
Phonics, so many minutes of phonics maybe, which is usually not enough minutes for the new learner. And I realized that because we work with struggling learners, talking about how many minutes really varies from student to student. It's the question, how much is too much, how much is enough, is a question that's really difficult for me to answer.
Well, and it really varies from student to student, but really also it varies from stage to stage, depending on where you are in the reading and writing learning process as well.
On top of it all, it can vary from day to day, and week to week, and month to month. So how can we think about this? What is the image, this concept that we could convey to help all of us think about how much language arts? And we came up with
a pie chart.
Yeah, a pie chart. Because a pie chart conveys proportions, right?
Yes.
Not exact amounts.
Right, which we all prefer when taking a slice of pie anyway.
That's right.
I want just a proportion of this pie, half or something like that.
Right, I want a big slice.
Right,
so
right.
Saying a slice.
It's proportional though.
Right, a slice of pie can be one thing for Maura and another for Claire and another one for Tracy and a really big one for me because I love pie. So
we're going to need more than one pie.
Yes,
we need one
four
pie.
People,
not
two pies.
For the four of us.
Yes. So as we think about pies, I want you to think about, okay, then now I'm picturing this pie and it's broken in six parts, say, phonics, spelling, word study, grammar, reading, writing. It was six parts. Can you believe it?
Nice.
Yes. Okay. And I'm picturing them all being equal, but that doesn't work either. It doesn't work for a lot of reasons. How different kids are. How different each stage in language arts can be. So
how different teachers are.
How different teachers are.
How different your emotional state might be from day to day.
And an important concept we'll hit again and again, that learning happens in relationship. So you also have how different the relationship, not just the teacher, not just the student, but how the teacher and the student are combining with each other in that particular moment for that particular subject.
Right.
And the student's relationship with the subject also.
Right.
So if this is really difficult for me, my tolerance level is going to be less than if it's something that I really adore doing, right? Some struggling learners find reading easier than writing. Some find writing easier than reading. Some find
spelling
listening
to be extremely difficult. Some
right.
find spelling to be easy, but reading is hard.
Right.
But eating pie is always easy.
Right.
Yeah. That's so true.
So while you're
really
listening,
what we're saying is if you're right. eating pie while you teach, all your problems will go away.
That's right. Which is why we feed our students pie.
Yeah.
And maybe this will all go down easier if you get yourself a piece of pie while you're listening to us.
All go down.
Okay. So as we think about this, what I would like to ask you to do is not think in terms of minutes and not think of dividing everything up. First of all, because we realize that a lot of these language arts areas overlap. But also thinking in terms of in any given week, let's say, not in this hour, not in this day, but in any given week, what might my language arts look like? And that is easier to think about in terms of proportions.
Yeah, I just kind of want to reiterate that, though, a little bit, because that can be...
That's a big concept.
It's a big concept, and it's a different way of thinking, I feel like, than a lot of people are approaching something that we're not talking about a daily or an hourly. We're talking about a weekly perspective. So you're zooming out really, really far from what you might normally be approaching it.
And I know a while back, Rita did a day in the life homeschool kind of look with the Learning Well community on their Instagram page. And she talked about how she used to plan her homeschool by months. She would take months and look at the month and kind of focus on things by month, which allowed you to take this kind of zoomed out approach and really plan what you were doing throughout your homeschool more proportionally rather than kind of driving yourself crazy in the nitty gritty, you know, did I get so many minutes of each of these things every day?
Right. It allows flexibility when yep. you do that for both the teacher and the student. But from the teacher perspective, you really have an opportunity to respond to the student or the child in any given day or moment that this is going really well. We're just cruising. I'm just going to stay with this particular aspect of language arts today. We're going to milk it for all it's worth, and you don't have to get hyper about that because, oh dear, I haven't touched on spelling and I haven't had any handwriting practice today. Doesn't matter. It's going great with reading. So we're just going to stick with reading, and tomorrow we'll deal with something else.
And I think it allows you to be a better teacher, too, if you're a little bit more zoomed out and thinking more proportionally as opposed to trying to kind of quantify everything, you know, because you're not pulling yourself in 1,000 directions. I know that even within a single session with a student, when I'm trying, if I try to make a plan that looks like, okay, I'm going to spend 10 minutes on this, and then 5 minutes on this, and then 12 minutes on this, and then, you know, 3 minutes on this, I will inevitably never make that happen mm-hmm. because I'll get, you know, I get pulled into the depth of whatever the first thing is that right. I started, and I realized that there's so much more there that we need to dig into that really trying to splice up my session like that never works, and honestly, my students would hate me if that's what I tried to do
right.
every session.
Well, and that was what I was going to say, is the added bonus that you get from the flexibility as a teacher is that students end up feeling like they've had a voice in their own learning as well. I was really liking this. I didn't want to stop and go on to, you know, I was loving the grammar. I didn't want to stop and go on to spelling. So, you know, stick with the grammar.
Yeah, or if there was good learning happening from that, even if it, you know, maybe it was a, you know, some struggle and some, you know, some engagement and some stickiness, it doesn't necessarily have to be because it was incredibly fun, but if, like, you were deep into something and
right.
it's like, well, time's up, we got to move on to spelling. You know, you've zoomed away from something that could have been a really actual learning opportunity that ended up sticking more in their head than if we have these kind of bits and pieces all over the place in my day. When I look back on my day, I really am not sure what I learned because I moved around too much.
Right. You never got to the deep learning
because
there was too much switching around.
Right.
I think the other thing about the month view is it also keeps you from avoiding things that need to happen too. So say I have a child who only likes reading, only likes listening, doesn't like reading himself. I'm taking this month-long view on this. I realize that, oh, okay, how about if you just read a couple sentences right here, and then we're just going to go on with this reading that you're really enjoying, because this is a day out of 30 days or a day out of, what is it, 7 times 4?
28.
28 days. Not 30. It's, you know, it's a day. Thank you. It's a day out of 28 days. It helps you say, I didn't avoid having him read for 20 out of 28 days. Today, this one day out of 28 days, he may not have done a lot of reading.
Right.
Tomorrow is another day.
Right. It gives you perspective. It gives you patience and time. Mm-hmm. Right. Because I often feel that the educator feels this, like, pressure mm-hmm. to get everything in every lesson. Right. And that's not going to happen.
I think the other value of this month-long perspective is when you have a project that you have decided that you're doing. So say, you know, I think I really want to work on this writing project with this student. We're reading a book and we are going to be doing some copy work out of that book, and we're going to be looking for themes, something like that. And then in the end, we're going to have this writing project where maybe we do some short narrative writing on free writing on three themes. That's my writing project for the month. Three little themes, little bits of writing on three themes. That's it for the month. So now when I have that month view, I can say, how do I want to break this up? What kinds of things will I be doing? If we are going to be looking at theme and maybe we need to do some literary element work, now I have a sense that over the course of that month, I need a proportion out of all these 28 days that's going to be looking at things like literary elements. And I have a proportion that's got to have some discussion. And I have a proportion that's going to have some read aloud. And I have a proportion that's going to have some free writing. And then I have a proportion that's going to look at that free writing and do some editing so we can begin to create this paper. This working backwards lets you just think in proportions and then think about, oh, and by the way, Monday's out because we always have co-op. And Friday's out because Friday's the day where we kind of always take half a day, only half a day.
Field trip or something.
Yes, yeah. And that just never seems to work. So now I'm down to these proportions that I'm going to be fitting nicely over 3 days, except not the week when my mom and dad are visiting. We're only going to do small amounts, and maybe I'll pick the easier things to do that week, and then I'm going to pick some of these harder things to do on the other week. So looking at things when you take this month-long view, like I said, it helps you hit everything. It doesn't let you forget things, but it also lets you have grace, not only for, as Tracy said, for when a good day is a good day going down one path we don't mm-hmm. want to get off of, but also for just how life can be.
Yeah, and the variability of how our students respond each day as well. You know, because I have a lot of parents say, wow, today was a great day, right? Sometimes, especially with the struggling learner, we have a lot of this variability in performance, right? That helps you not get so stressed out every time you have a day where the performance just seems to be lagging. There might be grinding to a slow halt. There might be, you know, a little bit of attitude. There might be seeming to have forgotten everything you taught the day before. That variability in performance, when you have this more patient month-long view, it helps you manage that as an educator better than this, you know, I'm kind of freaking out every time. I feel like I lost a day today.
So we've been talking in a little bit more of a general perspective about why you would look at something from this proportionate view. So to narrow it back down a little bit then to the kind of early introduction of language arts. So if you had...
Yeah, let's talk about our visual.
Yeah. Pull out your handy-dandy visual guide.
All right, guys, can't you see what we're showing you?
Well, there should be a blog, right?
There should be a blog. And on that blog, we're talking about the... So this is the introducing skills pie chart. And so this would be divided into these proportions for working with a student who is first learning to read and write. So you might be typically thinking about maybe kindergarten or age 5, or with maybe a struggling learner,
six.
Maybe they're a little older.
I was going to say, sometimes you're really introducing skills because reading took a while to really get started, and so they might be older than that with a struggling learner. You really want to think about where they are, not what age they are necessarily and where they should be, right? It's really about where they are.
They could have gaps in their skills.
They could have gaps and need to spend more time here, even if they're 9 or 10.
Right. So when introducing skills, we're generally looking at two very large portions, which is divided between sound practice and letter practice.
And I think people find this to be a little frustrating because it feels like you're going back to the basics if you have an older struggling learner. And there's a lot of debate out there, like, is phonics really all you need? Is that too much? Phonics doesn't answer all the questions. If you try to talk about spelling in terms of phonics, it doesn't work, which is somewhat true.
Or I've done phonics and they get it, but they're not applying
But they're not applying it. We see that a lot. The kids have had phonics, but they're really not applying it. And so I just want to give you a little bit of a view on this. I had shared this recently. I have been reading Marianne Wolfe's book, Proust and the Squid, and she was talking about different languages in different cultures, and she was talking about how even cultures that have very complex languages that kids have to spend years and years and years learning, and by the way, the English language is one of those, so it takes a long time to become proficient in reading, writing, and spelling in English because we're a complicated
hybrid language
system. And it's true of Chinese. People have to spend years, they spend like 6 years learning these 2,000 symbols that are used, over 2,000, Claire, you can correct me on this, symbols. And so what they do is they teach kind of this microcosm of what Chinese language is,
It's called pinyin.
And that little system helps them learn how the whole system is going to work. So I want you to think about that because that's what we do a lot at this introducing skills level.
It's like a code, right? Like it's like a key. Well, it's like a key to a code.
Well, and code is a good word to use because a lot of times people get a little confused by the terminology of learning the code or decoding, as we call it when we're first teaching kids to read and write, and we are essentially teaching them a key, teaching them a code,
We call writing encoding.
Yeah, right. Encoding.
Right.
And decoding.
So decoding is reading, encoding is writing. Reading is learning a code. You're right. And that code is like the entrance. It's the welcome into this world of literacy. This is generally how it works. It connects to our verbal language system. It connects to what we know about words, even though the way we spell everything may not be the same way we say everything. But even though phonics and phonological processing, the sound processing work that we do, has limitations, it's this smaller world that introduces kids to the world of literacy.
It's an entry to the code.
It's an entry to literacy.
The gateway code.
And the gateway code.
It's gateway behavior.
And it's the bridge back to their oral language.
Exactly.
How their brains are processing language already.
Right.
And that's a great point, Tracy, because I feel like a lot of times, sometimes the language system can get kind of separated out from reading and writing, when in reality, if we're teaching these little speakers to read and write, hopefully they have some language and are speaking already. Most of them do, right? We want to be using a system they already somewhat have in place. They're obviously still growing in their language skills, but they have a lot in place already that very much connects to our written text form of that language.
Right.
And so if we can use something, you think of it, it's like a gateway skill, right? It's like the skill they already have that will help them have a much better sort of sounding board for this new skill rather than keeping it separate. Why would we not want to draw on a strength they already have or a system they already have?
And that is the key to deep learning.
Right.
When you're trying to learn something new, you tie it back to something you already know.
Exactly. Connections.
Which is exactly what a metaphor is.
Waha! That's why metaphors exist. That's why they work.
and why we're using metaphors to help you, like pie, to help you understand things, right? Everyone here hopefully understands pie. Hopefully you've had some pie, you've enjoyed some pie.
And you understand the difference between a big piece of pie and a small piece of pie.
It's why we're using that metaphor.
So, thinking of pie, the very first pie has to have limited ingredients. It's kind of like kids are just learning. We limit the ingredients, but there are key ingredients that are going to continue throughout all of literacy.
And part of the reason we limit the ingredients is to ensure success, right? Which has kind of been an underpinning of what we've been talking about. But if you throw too much at once early on, the likelihood of success goes down. So if you're starting with something that is both foundational skills that you need for progress, but also these sort of bigger blocks, bigger ideas that they can wrap their heads around, right? You can actually bite a piece of that pie.
Right.
Ah.
So, nice.
So, well,
biting, eating, yeah.
And to go back to when Maura was talking earlier about your student might be an older student, if you had a student or have a student who struggles, and so you've delayed the reading and writing process.
On purpose.
Right.
It has happened.
That's just what's happened. They might very well understand pieces all over the place. But to mix our metaphors, it might be a road full of potholes. So what you're trying to do by going back through this is to fill in those holes so that it's a
holes
smooth...
in the pie.
Right. It looks good for company. Right. No. Just kidding.
So to paint you a picture of the introducing skills pie, you have your circle, your pie shape, and there aren't actually going to be that many pieces because really you're focusing on kind of mostly two big skill areas that are taking up most of your pie. So you can imagine it kind of being shaped almost like a peace sign. And
kind of a skinny peace sign.
Yeah, kind of a peace sign. And if you go to the blog, you'll see this lovely chart that Tracy created, and it's, you know, got the beautiful watercolors. We're trying to make it nice and visually pleasing for you. But you'll see that there's one big side, sound practice. Another side, letter practice. And that's taking up most of your pie. And then you practice each of those things, sound practice and letter practice, in the kind of umbrella skills, the code of reading and the code of writing. And that's really all the slices you have.
Yes, but those reading and writing at this stage is in those slices are bits, right? So they're skinny slices. So you have these big slices of the sound practice and big slices of letter practice. And then you have it practiced in these bits.
Because you can't be really practicing much more than bits at this point. If it's introductory, they don't have a lot of code for reading. They don't have a lot of code for writing. In fact, that's what the sound and letter practice is really doing. It's introducing that code, and we're trying to kind of get it consolidated, we say a lot of the times, in the larger skill of reading and writing. But that can't happen very largely because they don't have a lot there.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And why is it so important that why are we so focused on this sound letter practice?
Well, because practicing those foundational elements, really ultimately the goal is that it's building toward automaticity. So you're working toward these foundational pieces becoming as automatic as possible so that you're not spending all of your brain energy on coming up with the sound a letter makes or the symbol for it, so the actual formation of the letter. Instead, it's smooth, it comes easily, it comes really kind of without thinking about it.
It looks instantaneous.
Yeah, it looks instantaneous. But you can't get to that point unless you're explicitly and carefully practicing each of those pieces beforehand.
Proportionally, spending a lot of your time on sound and letter practice at this introductory stage, right? And not worrying about all of the other pieces of language art quite as much, because you want to get this really solid and automatic as much as you can so that it's taking up less space when you start folding in these other pieces.
And incidentally, we had touched earlier on the fact that sometimes kids have already been exposed to phonics, maybe a lot of phonics, but it doesn't seem to stick when they go to read or they go to write. They're still having a great deal of difficulty. And what they're missing is that automatic connection between the letter and the sound it makes.
Yeah, a lot of times there's a lot of like splinter learning that happens where they've kind of picked up pieces of the letter system, our kind of symbol system. They've picked up pieces of maybe what some of these sounds are. They haven't made really strong connections. They might be using a lot of visual skills, so they're trying to kind of memorize a lot of things. And you have a kind of looks like reading until you get to about third grade and suddenly they kind of fall apart. And that might be where you really have to kind of go back to this, okay, wait a second, I might need to be spending huge pie portions on this sound to letter again. I might be back to this kind of introductory skill building, code building, making connections between these two things really, really solid so that we can now move forward efficiently. Even if it seems like some of the things were kind of in place, there were holes all over your pie. So you got to fill in those big areas. It happened to me when I learned piano. I learned piano kind of in these splinter skills right at the beginning. I got about a year into piano, and my teacher moved away, and I had a new teacher who basically said, you've got holes all over your pie. We've got to go back and spend huge amounts of time filling in these big pieces of
and music. And did you love that
of
idea
music
more?
Reading and note reading. I didn't really know how to read music, but I had been able to kind of piece together enough that I was seemingly playing. And no, I wasn't happy. But after about a couple months of doing that, I started to realize, wait a second, there's all this stuff that now I feel so much more solid in. Mm-hmm. And I felt a lot better moving forward because I had filled in those holes where I was really kind of stumbling forward in the dark before, but didn't want to go backwards because it seemed like moving backwards.
And I think if you're listening and asking yourself, well, could this be my child? I think the question is, are you hitting roadblocks? Is, you know, things like there are letter reversals that just are not resolving. You are hitting a roadblock. Or
their spelling is just a mess.
Yeah, spelling is a mess. That's a roadblock. Or they may read, but they refuse to write. That's mm-hmm. another roadblock. They'll only dictate. They won't write themselves.
Or when they read out loud, they're guessing at a good portion of the words that they come across.
Right. A lot of inaccuracies. Or the rate is very slow. I mean, there's many things. Or that great listening skills, but I just am having trouble with reading. Or the child has to sound out every single word, and then they see the next word one paragraph later and they don't recognize that's the word they had just sound out.
That's what I was going to say, the variability. You just read that, but now you can't read it.
Right. And so what you're seeing there is that kids have not developed this strong foundation, this automaticity. And, you know, just to keep playing on the pie metaphor, you know, you've got to have that bottom crust. You know, or you have stuff spilling out all over creation. And this is the stage, no matter the age, where we really go in and just work on these foundational skills. Does that mean that this is all spelling's going to ever be for this child? No. Does that mean we never would talk about grammar? No. Does that mean somewhere else you might not be doing lots of listening and letting them dictate to you? Absolutely. But for most of your effort that you think about for this student for language arts, we've got to be working on these skills. And this is the hard thing about kids in the classroom, because the reality is things don't slow down for that student.
And there's kind of too many goals and benchmarks that have to be hit.
That have to be hit. And so all they can do is keep moving these students along, even though all this foundational work needs to be done. And if you are an educator and that is your situation and you have kids in your classroom like that, you really need to get your intervention specialist and your speech language therapist involved, because somebody's got to be spending, and parents, people have got to be spending time working on these skills with mm-hmm. kids. If we skip this whole introductory pie, we're in trouble.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And now some of you will say, oh yeah, but my neighbor's kid, they never did anything but read all the time, and he just got it all, and he didn't have to spend any time on this sound to symbol connection.
Woohoo.
Yeah. Lucky for that one
really
percentile,
lucky.
Right?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. So what we really know from the research is this is a stage that the functional MRIs help show us are really happening in kids' brains. Do they begin? Some kids very quickly will begin to be taking on other kinds of skills. They might move very quickly to the next pie.
They're just mapping things all over the place,
right,
really fast.
Right. They have strong underlying language skills that are needed for reading. It's not that they're really pre-programmed for it, but they have a lot of natural ability to get there. But most of us spend time learning.
The reality is reading is a learned skill, and I know there's a lot of controversy about this sometimes, because you will have those cases that look like I didn't teach my child anything and bam, he could read and it was perfect, right? Those kids are still learning. They're just learning. They have a lot of natural ability that's enabling them to learn really fast, but they still learn to read even if it didn't seem like someone needed to teach them. There's always going to be these kids who seemingly pick up things completely on their own without a lot of explicit instruction.
And incidentally, I'm sorry to interrupt your thought, but if you have a child that you're just introducing reading to and they're moving at that pace, this does not hurt them. It only helps them.
Explicit instruction will just go fast.
Right. So to still have that pie be limited, to still be focusing that introductory time on sound practice and letter practice is still best practice for that child.
Well, and 2 points there. People tend to disregard all the phonics work they did for years when these kids one day just magically started doing it. They almost act like we were just listening to a speaker who did this. I mean, there was all this conversation about all these attempts, and different efforts being made, and then one day the child
magically,
you know, just started reading. Well, that's disregarding everything that went on before. That's the equivalent of me saying to Tracy, well, you're just a really good artist, as though she did no work toward that, right? As though she just popped out of the ground as this good artist. Now, the truth is, she may have had a real interest in that, and she may have had some natural connections to that.
Well,
which,
certainly a lot of natural drive.
Right.
As well.
She also had parents who actually facilitated that in ways they were
your
artists.
Your mom's an artist.
Oh,
yes.
Wait.
Your mom's an artist. Had something to do with it.
No one in my household was doing that or showing me that. You know, would I be different had I had more experience? And here's another thought. Tracy spent more time drawing in her childhood years than I did. I didn't really like it and didn't do it. And that's the reality, too, of some of these natural readers, is they really liked it, they spent hours doing it, and some of the struggling readers are avoiding it.
Right.
So we do need time in practicing. It may be that your child can only tolerate this in 10-minute blocks. So make your 10-minute blocks look like the right proportions. Come back to it later in the day. Revisit it again in another subject area, but definitely be thinking proportionally all the time.
Yeah, and on that week, from that sort of weekly or monthly perspective, less of a daily perspective.
So let's wrap up with a quote. Rita was talking earlier about Dr. Marion Wolfe and Proust and the Squid, and here's a quote from that book that has a lot to do with what we've been saying. This is a quote, before I read it, that we put into our new Pinwheels product, which Rita also mentioned at the beginning. If you're unfamiliar with that, that's something we've been working on for a while. We hope to have it out sometime this fall, which is a product to introduce or to teach new readers.
Yeah, a comprehensive literacy program.
Right. So here's the quote. This is the essence of what is called the alphabetic principle, and it depends on your brain's uncanny ability to learn to connect and integrate at rapid-fire speeds what it sees and what it hears to what it knows. So our interpretation of that is that we begin with simple sounds, which is what we hear, matched to letters, which is what we see, and tied to meaning by creating simple words, which is what we already know.
Thank you for joining us for episode 1 of season 3. If you listened all the way through, we're very excited to offer a discount code for our website. The code is FIRSTSLICE, FIRSTSLICE, as a, hey, you've dug into your pie, so grab a first slice. And that's good for 10% off everything on our website, classes, and instructional materials. If you want to know more about Rooted in Language, you can visit us on our website, rootedinlanguage.com. You can also check out our YouTube channel, our Facebook page, and join our Facebook community group, The Rooted Community.